sing to Jesus, Lord of our shame, Lord of our sinful hearts. He is our great Redeemer. Sing to Jesus, honor His name. Sing of His faithfulness, pouring His life out unto death.
Surprised by joy. Let's pray. Almighty God, as I speak the word that you have given to me, would you move in the congregation? Cause your wind to blow in our hearts and our spirits. Lord, free us from bondage. open the way before us.
Jesus.
Make our path clear, Lord Jesus, and give us the courage to walk that path, that road of holiness, by the power of your Spirit, by the washing of your blood. Lord Jesus, spring up in us today with joy.
Yes.
I pray in your holy name. Amen. Hannah was in such a difficult place with Peninnah. Both the wives of Elkanah. Desperately, she wanted to have a baby. With all of her heart, she desired a child. She desired a child because she loved her husband so much. And she was barren, and God had made her that way. That's what the word says. Out of that barrenness, she would come into the presence of God and she would weep. And Peninnah would taunt her, would ridicule her, made her life unbearable, provoking her to pray. And then you remember she comes in to the tent of meeting, to the presence of Almighty God. And there, without making any pretense or any show, she simply is pouring her heart out to God. And the high priest, the doughboy, loving his filet mignon, loving his lifestyle, allowing his sons to commit adultery with the women who serve at the temple, he's sitting kicked back on his chair. And he rebukes her, saying she's drunk and telling her that she should lay off the beer. Her heart is crushed. Even the high priest of God taunts her. And she quickly says, oh no, I was crying out to the Lord. I'm not drunk. I need the Lord. He sees his mistake. He says, your request has been granted. I'm sure he'd said that to many others. He was a blessed, quick pastor, always saying that pleasant word, never rebuking, never a sharp confrontation, just that blessing. She took that and believed it and went home and became pregnant. Now there's a problem. God would not answer her prayer until she made a vow to God to give the very thing that her heart most desired back to God. How does a mother give her child back? Knowing he's not going to be home for Christmas, not going to be home for Thanksgiving, giving that child away totally and completely. How does a mother do that? How does a father do that? What's Elkanah thinking when Hannah says, I want to take your son and I want to give him to the wicked high priest, Eli, who's going to train him up in the way of God? How does a father allow that to happen? Do you love your children? Are they precious to you? Would you give them away? Are there any circumstances under which you can imagine giving your son or your daughter away? How about your grandchildren? Yeah, maybe. No. I love my grandchildren. It would break my heart. How do we even begin to talk about this? See, we can't just talk about this in terms of children. It's everything in our heart that is so precious to us. It is our blood. Some of you don't have children. Would you give away your job because another man was in desperate need of a job and he had a family to support? Would you give him your job and resign and say, you take my job because you need the money for your children? Would you give that man your job? What would you be willing to give away? Would you give your health for another that they might live? What about your money? The money that you have been entrusted with by God, and you have put it away, and that is your future? Would you give that away? And as soon as I ask the question, some of you begin to think through how that money came. Would you give that away? Maybe I ought to ask the question another way. What are you willing to give away? Is there anything you'd be willing to give away? I want to share with you a story today. Some of you know this story well, but it will be new for a number of you and a wonderful review for those of you who have read it. I'm going to read for you a brief section from the book Rees Howells, Intercessor, by Norman Grubb. Rees Howells was called by God at a very young age to commit himself totally and completely to the Lord. He was a coal miner. And then he discovered that he could make more money in America, and so he came to America and worked over here. And while he was here, met a Jewish man in Pittsburgh who had utterly sold himself out to the Lord God of heaven and lost his entire fortune. The family kicked him out of the family business, and they cut him off. Well, Rees saw this radical kind of Christianity, and the Lord said, go back home. And so he headed back to Wales, and he was then able to minister in the Welsh revival. But he continued as a miner, working at the face of the coal, until finally one day the Lord said to him, do you believe I can take care of you as well as the coal mine owner can take care of you? And he said, yes. So the Lord called him out of coal mining and put him into full-time ministry. You'll have to read the story. He tested Rees Howells on every point. He would allow for no variance. He tested him with his wife. He wanted to wed this beautiful woman. And then the Lord said no. And for 3 years, they walked separately. And after 3 years, the Lord said, now you can marry her. And so with joy, they were wed. And now he's preaching. And for some time, he's been preaching. And the ministry has so absorbed him that there's been no time for intercession. No time for nights of prayer because he's so exhausted from the work he's doing. Let's pick the story up. From the time I began to preach, there was no further place of intercession gained because all my hours and thoughts were given to that work. And then Norman Grubb picks it up. But he was the same Rees Howells. One day, he and a fellow student passed a thinly clad tramp shivering with the cold. Mr. Howells at once took off his overcoat and gave it to the tramp. In the midst of all of this, God called again. The Howells had a burden of prayer for some missionary friends in West Africa. Mr. and Mrs. Stauber of the Angola Evangelical Mission, Rees and Elizabeth felt they should help them in some way, and while they were asking the Lord about it, they read in their magazine that a little girl, Edith, had been born to the Stauders. Mr. Howells knew that West Africa was no climate for children, so he told his wife that this would be a good chance to help them. They could take the little girl while the parents were in Africa. It was a real test. Mrs. Howells would now be tied at home, and yet the child would never become theirs. She made the decision. If they give their lives for Africa, she said, I will give mine for the child. They wrote and told them, but the answer came that they were soon coming home, and they could talk it over then. I met my friend Stauder in a convention shortly after this. He did not say anything for the first few days, and it wasn't until I was on my way to the missionary meeting that he told me how thankful he and his wife were for the offer we had made, but that they were not wanting to leave Edith just then. I walked straight into the meeting, and there I saw a vision of Africa. Mrs. Albert Head was speaking on behalf of the South African General Mission and pleading for a married couple to take the place of Mr. and Mrs. Edgar Faithful as he was becoming the Home Secretary. I had heard many people speaking on the need of the mission field, but I never saw the heathen in their need until that afternoon. The Lord gave me a vision of them, and they stood before me as sheep without a shepherd. Reese returned home on Saturday and told Elizabeth especially about the married couple. That night they prayed for this couple, and they could not stop praying for a long time. When they did stop, they could not sleep. And before morning, the Lord had said, "I will answer your prayer through you. I will send you both to Africa." "It was the greatest surprise of our lives," said Reese. "We thought we had a vision of the Africans in order to burden us to pray for someone else to go. But with the Lord, we can only push others as far as we are willing to be pushed ourselves." There were 1,000 hindrances, but the Lord would take no excuse. Where there's a will, there's a way. The greatest problem was that a little boy had been born to them. At the time they had offered to adopt Edith, they had no child. We had told each other that those missionaries ought to give the child up and devote all their time to the work. But we little thought that we were preparing a trap for ourselves. What we thought others should do, we were now called to do. Months before their little boy was born, the Lord told them to call his name Samuel. There was no Samuel in the family. It was given them just as the name of John was given to Zechariah. There were several similarities in his life to the one that was named after, one being that Mrs. Howell's name was Hannah. She too was now to put her son on the altar of sacrifice. "It was our first test on the call, and the greatest," said Mr. Howells, who tells this story in his own words. The Savior had said, "Anyone who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me." And now the Holy Ghost said to us, "You must prove to me that you love the souls of the Africans who are to live for eternity more than you love your own son." Does he really mean it? I wondered. Yes, he meant it, just as he told Abraham to take his only son up the mountain and offer him as a whole burnt offering. Many a time I had preached about Abraham giving up Isaac and had emphasized the words, "Take now thy son, thine only son, whom thou lovest." How little had I realized what that had meant to him. I knew what it was to give my life, but to give another's life away was as different as two things could possibly be. God had given us Samuel's name before he was born, and I knew he had a purpose for his life, and this was our test. God said, "If you give him up, you can never claim him again." Not once has it ever dawned on us since then that Samuel was ours. We were to surrender him as really as God surrendered his own son and Abraham his son. Unless your surrender is real and up to the standard, you will break down long before the end.
Oh, Jesus.
It wasn't a question of leaving Samuel behind, then that he should call our attention back to himself. No thought of Samuel was to bring us back to this country from Africa. The time came for my wife to take a course of Bible training. We did not know what place the Lord would open for little Samuel. We left it entirely in the hands of the Lord. We wouldn't have dared to interfere, or we could have made a great mistake. A few weeks before the time for us to leave, I was sent for by my uncle, a brother of the one who was healed. His wife was the headmistress in the county school where they lived. He asked if we were taking Samuel with us. I said, no. Where is he going to go? I said, I didn't know. Well, he said, he's to come here with us. They had never seen him, although they lived within 3 or 4 miles. But he said that a few nights before, something came over them about him, and they wanted to nurse him while we were away. In a couple of days, they were going to come and see him. Walking home that day to tell my wife was more than one could bear. Although we had given him up in our hearts, when the Lord actually opened a door for him, it was like pulling one's heart to pieces. But before I had reached home, I had enough victory to control myself. It would have been no use for me to show my wife that I was giving way. When I arrived home, she was playing with Samuel. I thought I'd never seen him as he was that night. And for a time, I could not break the news. But I took courage, and I told her. The scene that followed can better be imagined than described. And we were glad we only had to go through it once in a lifetime. We proved that night that Africa was going to cost us something. We were coming up to the victory by degrees. The process was slow and hard because it was going to be an intercession. One had to walk at every inch. I want to stop there a minute. He's using some terms that you may not be familiar with. We come out of a very sentimental, weak kind of religious faith. Rhys Howells is talking about the kind of faith where you come into the presence of God and you give over to the hand of God whatever he asks you to give over to him. And once given over into the hand of God, it cannot be taken back. When he asks for the sin to be given into his hand, we give that thing into his hand and we don't go back to it. It's called intercession. It's not a self-help process. It's a blood-bought process done by the Holy Spirit. It's done by grace in our hearts. It's a miracle that God performs on our behalf. And when he steps in and asks us to give into his hand that thing which he desires to change, we've got to come up to it. We don't get there all at once. We get there a piece at a time. We slowly step in, and we step in, and it's agony. Through my life, I have been an avid reader, and the genre that I enjoyed most was science fiction. I began reading science fiction in high school, and it opened a whole new world for me, and I devoured it, and the Lord began to speak to me and say, it's unclean. Give it to me. It's of the occult. It's of witchcraft. Give it to me. And I would give it to the Lord until I saw the next new book. And then I wanted to read it. And it went back and forth like this. And finally, I gave it totally over to the Lord. And then last week, I went into a bookstore. And I saw there advertised a teenage book in science fiction, the latest one out. I said, I want to know what they're saying. So I picked it up and I began to read it, and I was enthralled by it. I didn't buy it. I laid it back down. And all that afternoon, my thoughts kept going back to the storyline of this book. And I began to see that it was blocking my presence in the throne room of God. And I said, Lord, what is this? All I did was pick up this simple science fiction book. And the Lord said to me, I told you to lay it down. You've touched something unclean, and I will not receive you while you touch that which is unclean. And I immediately got on my face before God and began to repent and say, Lord, I am sorry, forgive me. Now I tell you, it's done. But it's not done in my flesh. The moment I decide in my spirit to become rebellious, I can go back and open up all of those occultic doors. It's the popular literature of our day. It is the most popular literature of our day. Harry Potter introducing children, training children in witchcraft. Unclean, dark, of the occult. So what I'm wanting you to hear today is that as we step into something, the Lord will speak to us, either by withdrawing so that we don't hear his voice, and his silence speaks louder than words, or he will speak to us about something in our life, and he will say, will you step into this? Will you give me this? It may even be something good. Never forget the time when he gave me a dream. I was sitting in a living room, and as I watched myself in the dream, I saw that I was grieving. And then suddenly, I was inside of that person in my dream, and it was me. And I knew that my wife, Jan, had just died. And in the dream, the Lord came to me and said to me, now am I enough for you, or do you have to have your beloved? And with weeping in my dream, I said, Lord, you're enough for me. And instantly I was awake, and my sweetheart was there. But I looked at her differently than I had before, because now I knew Jesus was enough for me. I had given Jan to Jesus. I don't need to control her. I don't need to change her. I don't need to chastise her. Just like she is, she's responsible before Jesus. She's not mine anymore. I'm married to her. She's the love of my heart. But she's not mine. She belongs to Jesus, because he asked for her, and I gave her. I hope you understand, the things we're speaking about today don't just happen quickly. It takes deliberate decision-making on our part that we will step in and give to the Lord what he asks us to give, whether it's an unclean thing that we are tempted to reach out and touch, or if it is something that we love that is beautiful, or something that we possess that we covet. And the Lord steps in and he says, will you give that to me? And in our heart we say, how could I ever be happy and not have my wife Jan? How could I be happy if Jan were to die? How could I survive? How could I lead the congregation without my wife at my side? How could I do that? So the lie that Satan comes and brings to my heart is that if you follow the way of God and you give to God what he asks you to give, you're going to be unhappy. Because all I have is what I have. And if I give that away, I won't have any more. We were coming up to victory by degrees. The process was slow and hard because it was going to be an intercession. One had to walk every inch. The breaking of sin in your life is an intercession, and it has to be done one step at a time. My uncle and aunt came up. They'd never seen a child like him. Without a doubt, the Lord had put a father's and mother's love in their hearts toward him. The first thing they did was to invite my sister to be his nurse. It was like Miriam and Moses. The morning came when my sister arrived to fetch him. I think in eternity we shall look back on what we went through then, giving our best to the Lord. We knew what it was to give money, health, and many other things. But this was by far the hardest test. The devil was not quiet that morning. He said I was the hardest man in the world to give my little boy up. The worst of all was to enter into the feelings of my wife, preparing his clothing. His going out was more than emptying the house. He emptied our hearts, too. When I came that night, I asked my wife, "How did you get through?" She said she went into the garden and wept and thought to herself, "I've been singing that hymn many a time, but we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. And this morning I have to prove it." But then the Lord told me, "Measure it with Calvary." And with those words, she came through. In praying together afterward, the Lord showed me the reward. He said to us, "For everything you give me, there is a 100-fold return. And on this you can claim 10,000 souls in Africa." And we believed it. After Mr. and Mrs. Howes left for Africa, Samuel became so completely a son to Mr. and Mrs. Reese that his name was changed to Samuel Reese. He grew up with them and later went to Oxford University, where he graduated. It was with him, literally, as with Samuel of old, that he seemed set apart for the Lord and served him from his youth up. He accepted Christ as his personal Savior at the age of 12. His adopted parents wanted him to become a doctor, but Samuel felt the Lord's call to the ministry. After his university course, he came back to join his own father. With his foster parents' loving consent, although Mr. and Mrs. Howes never raised one finger to draw him in their direction, it was God who sent him back to them. And Samuel became assistant director of the Bible College, of which, after his father's home calling, he became the director and was once again known to everybody by the name of Samuel Reese Howes. How perfectly the Lord fulfilled the promises given to his father and mother even before his birth, and how abundantly the Lord honored and sacrificed the sacrifice made by his parents in giving him up, the love and care showered on him by his foster parents. Now, I don't have time to tell you the whole story, but just a part of it. He went to Africa. They went to Africa. And in the first mission station, they began to pray for revival. And suddenly, awesome revival came. The power of God came down in that African mission station. And the power of God exploded in that place. And then a great influenza swept Africa, taking the lives of many. Reese Howes was told by the Lord, "Not one person who comes to the mission station will die." And so men who before had been unwilling to accept the Lord humbly came with their families to the mission station, and not one who came died. And the Lord received great glory. He did receive those 10,000 souls for eternal kingdom of God by his sacrifice. The Lord was faithful to him. Now I want you to see something in the book of 1 Samuel. I'm going to begin reading for you in verse 22. This is 1 Samuel 1, verse 22. Hannah did not go. That is, after the child was born, she did not continue to go up to Jerusalem. She didn't continue to go up to Shiloh for the feast days.
She said to her husband, "After the boy is weaned, I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there always." The age of weaning is sometime between the age of 3 and 4, usually, sometimes as late as 5. We don't know in this case. Verse 23, "Do what seems best to you," Elkanah, her husband, told her. "Stay here until you have weaned him. Only may the Lord make good his word." So the woman stayed at home and nursed her son until she had weaned him. And after he was weaned, she took the boy with her, young as he was, along with a 3-year-old bull, an ephod of flour, a skin of wine, and brought him to the house of the Lord in Shiloh. When they had slaughtered the bull, they brought the boy to Eli, and she said to him, "As surely as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who stood here beside you praying to the Lord. I prayed for this child, and the Lord has granted me what I ask of him. So now I give him to the Lord. For his whole life he will be given over to the Lord." And he worshiped the Lord there. And Hannah went home without him, and her home was empty. And the most astonishing thing happened, beyond my imagination. The power of God fell on her, and the spirit of joy began to fill her heart. And instead of going home weeping, mourning for the loss of her son, she went home rejoicing. Look, it's in the Word. Yeah. Then Hannah prayed, chapter 2, verse 1. "My heart rejoices in the Lord. In the Lord, my strength is lifted high. My mouth boasts over my enemies, for I delight in your deliverance. There is no one holy like the Lord. There is no one beside you. There is no rock like our God." Now, do you understand? When you have been called upon by the Lord God of heaven to lay on the altar either that thing which is sin or that thing which is precious to your heart, when you lay that on the altar, instead of being downcast like Satan says, a great spirit of joy wells up in your heart, and you enter into a place of freedom that you could not have even begun to imagine. Satan has lied to us.
Yeah.
He has said it's hard to serve the Lord. He has said it is grievous to follow the road of holiness. He has said it's impossible for you to walk sanctified before God. He said, that's legalism. You can't do it. But when we step into that place with God and we surrender to Him what He has asked us to surrender, joy leaps up in our heart and freedom begins to flow out of our hearts. Satan is the great liar. He's the one who puts us in bondage. He's the one who steals our joy. He's the one who rips away from us our hope for the future. Satan is the one who comes enticing us to step into darkness and uncleanness. Satan is the one who says, hang on to what you've got because that's all you're going to get. Satan is the one who comes and lies to us. He's the father of lies. Just the opposite is true. When we step into the Lord, joy explodes in our heart. And if you had no joy explode in your heart, it's because you have not radically stepped into the Lord yet, and you're still hanging on to that thing which God has asked you to totally surrender. Oh, my brother, sister, what has God asked you to give Him? Has He asked you to give Him your children? Has He asked you to give Him your money? Has He asked you to give Him your future? Has He asked you to give Him what you want to do for Him? And Satan is lying to you and saying, if you give that to God, God will steal it from you. And you'll be miserable. What are you hanging on to that God has asked you to give up? Don't believe the lies of Satan. Explosive joy comes out of radical obedience to the Lord God of heaven.
Some of you would say to me, Pastor, I can't hear God. I read the scriptures and they're like cardboard to my mouth. I go to sleep. I have no hunger. I can tell you why. You're so full of the things of darkness. You're so full of death. You're so full of the world that God has turned his face aside from you. And that path leads into destruction. Now, some of you have said to me, Pastor, I've turned toward the Lord, but I'm still in confusion. Yes. When you begin to take steps toward the Lord, those steps are going to be very painful and very hard. You're going to be stepping out into blind darkness. And you're not going to hear God speaking. He's already spoken. It's not until you finally stepped over that thing and totally given it over to God that that explosive joy rises up in your heart and the Lord God of heaven begins to freely converse with you. But know that after you've done that, he'll start on the next one. Because his intent is that everything that Satan has told you to hang on to, you will release into the hand of God, because he wants to give you life and life abundantly. Because the Lord God of heaven is not a thief, and he's not a man that he should lie. He is one who brings joy, but he always brings it through discipline, through testing. Because he knows that the joy is found in stepping out of that autonomous place where we're saying, I'm in control. I make the decisions. And as he calls us out of that place of independence that Adam and Eve stepped into, we are a testimony before the universe that God's word is true and faithful, that he is not a liar, and that he has not tried to steal from us joy. Now listen, she can't contain herself. Verse 3, do not keep talking so proudly or let your mouth speak such arrogance, for the Lord is a God who knows, and by him deeds are weighed. You know, you can hear who she's speaking to, can't you? She's talking to Penea. You know, she's saying, Penea, I don't want to hear any more proud talk out of you. I don't want any more arrogance out of you. For the Lord knows, and he has weighed your deeds and mine. Those are not bad words to say to the world. You might try it. The bows of the warriors are broken, but those who stumbled are armed with strength. Those who were full hire themselves out for food, but those who were hungry hunger no more. She was barren, has borne 7 children, but she who has had many sons pines away. So now the tables are totally turned. Penea is the one who is now grieving because she never had the love of her husband. All she had was this ability to birth children and lord it over the other wife. But Hannah, she stepped over the line and she has given everything to the Lord God of heaven, and he has given her the perfect ability to bear children. And now she rejoices, for the children are not what make her somebody. Elkanah is not the one who makes her somebody. She's somebody because when she prays, the Lord God of heaven hears her prayers. Does the Lord hear your prayers and answer them? Then you have reason to rejoice, for you have given into the hand of God all that he has asked of you. Verse 6, the Lord brings death and makes alive. He brings down to the grave and rises up. The Lord sends poverty and wealth. He humbles, he exalts, he raises the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes and has them inherit a throne of honor. For the foundations of the earth are the Lord's. Upon them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his saints, but the wicked will be silenced in darkness. It is not by strength that one prevails.
Those who oppose the Lord will be shattered. He will thunder against them from heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the horn or the strength of his anointed. Then Elkanah went home to Ramah, but the boy ministered before the Lord under Eli the priest. Do you see? The Lord came and said, "Will you give me your child?" And instead of pulling back and embracing and saying, "No, this is too precious to me," she opened her arms wide and she gave that child to the Lord Jesus. Today the Lord's asking, will you give your husband to Jesus? Will you give your wife to Jesus? Will you give your sons and your daughters to Jesus? Will you give your money to Jesus? Will you give your reputation to Jesus? Will you give your ministry, your dreams, will you give that to Jesus? Will you give to Jesus the lusting after pornography? Will you give to Jesus the temptation to go into the occult, science fiction? Will you give to Jesus the need to be somebody? Will you give it to Jesus as he asks for it and you step into it? The explosive joy of Hannah will rise up in your soul and you will go home in peace. Lord God, there is so much of darkness that lies to our hearts and tells us that if we give to you, Lord, what you have asked for, we will have nothing.
Yes.
And Lord, I bear testimony today before this congregation that everything you have asked of me and I have given to you, joy has flowed out of that giving. Not bitterness and not hardship, but joy has sprung up in my heart and my soul. I ask, Lord, that you would honor the giving of every man and woman, every boy and girl in this house today. I thank you, Jesus, in your holy name.
Joy of the Lord is my salvation. salvation, so beautiful to me. Lord, you are so faithful to me. Lord, you are so faithful to me. The joy of the Lord is my salvation, so beautiful to me, so beautiful to me.
This has been another broadcast of Pilgrim's Progress, brought to you by the National Prayer Chapel. Thank you for listening. We're a house church located in Woodbridge, Virginia. Come visit us at nationalprayerchapel.com or our sister website, revivalnow.church. God bless you. We love you.
I am resolved no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, these have allured my sight. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to go to the Savior, leaving my sin and strife. He is the true one, he is the just one, he hath the words of life. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. I will come to thee. I am resolved to follow the Savior, faithful and true each day. Heed what he saith, do what he willeth, he is the living way. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will.